chills.
Number 5, the Eyeless Creatures of Lake Natron. Nick Brandt was a worldly photographer roaming the African country of Tanzania when he came across a strange and deadly lake unlike any other in the world. The landscape before him was a strange blend of morbid beauty and terror that he could not look away from. Its ashen black coast was dark and foreboding, yet its tranquil waters were a bright pinkish-orange hue that was alluring. When the photographer got closer, he found dead animals everywhere. These animals, which mostly ranged from bats to birds, had been dead for quite some time, but aside from missing their eyes, they otherwise showed no signs of decay. Nick noticed the carcasses were covered with an ashy type of soot that made them dry and brittle, but aside from being crusted over with a strange mystery substance, they were perfectly preserved. The explorer was able to see with crystal clarity the tiny tip of a bat's tongue hanging out of its head, along with all of the various small hairs on its face as it lay lifeless on the shoreline. Without thinking, Nick propped some nearby corpses into lifelike positions and started snapping some of the most haunting natural photographs to ever be recorded. It's as if the eyeless creatures have come back from the dead for one last chance to experience the world that they were so cruelly ripped away from. Nick had come across Lake Natron, a bizarre natural wonder in Tanzania's northern regions. This would have just been another ordinary lake if not for the nearby mineral springs and a volcano regularly releasing a mixture of sodium carbonate, natural baking soda, and sodium salts into the water supply. These chemicals made the water extremely acidic, enough to kill most animals. Only the strongest survived. Being so close to a volcano also makes these waters extremely hot, up to 160 degrees Fahrenheit at certain times of the year. Only extremely hardy fish, certain types of birds such as flamingos, and the most hardcore forms of algae can survive Lake Natron. The rest of nature perishes as soon as they enter the lake. The water actually gets its color due to the brightly colored waste matter that the algae gives off, and the flamingos are also a bright color from eating the algae. Anyways, that's a nice science lesson and all, but let's get straight into the gore. The oddly colored water of Lake Natron can cast some strange reflections overhead in the sky, and these reflections often attract local bats and birds as they fly high above. These bats and birds have been known to become confused by the water's reflection and accidentally dive in, only to have their eyes and skin burned off as they flap about in boiling hot waters. After this painful demise, they are then preserved by the chemicals and eventually washed ashore as the lifelike corpses that Nick later found. While many of the animals wind up covering the shore, many others are unrecoverable. Plus, who knows what else has been preserved in the lake over the years besides birds and bats? After all, the caustic body of water has been around for a long time, and no one can say for certain that there is not a perfectly preserved human body in the waters waiting to be discovered. Or something even worse. Number 4, the Alley of the Skeletons. Pompeii was an ancient Roman city near the coast of Italy, and its citizens were very well cultured and fortunate. Aside from being protected by the Roman army, they also had the latest in technological advances, including heated baths, fresh water, and even cosmetic surgery for the upper class. They were also well known for growing the best onions and olives in the region, and enjoyed a fair amount of trade with neighboring areas as a result. Life seemed too good to be true at the time, a golden age that would never come to an end. However, even the Roman army could not save the merchant town from the natural elements that would one day destroy them forever. Unbeknownst to them, thousands of lives would soon be buried under choking ash, many for good. First, an earthquake rocked the city. The Pompeii citizens were a very brave people, and when they were faced with a choice to rebuild or move, they decided to stay and continue to prosper. Then, decades later, a nearby volcano started erupting on August 24th, 79 AD, and they would never recover. The violent volcano erupted in three separate surges of hot death, hurling boiling gases and ashes at the city at 62 miles per hour. In no time at all, the city was cast into darkness by plumes of suffocating volcanic ash. Thousands upon thousands of people screamed in terror as they trampled each other in pitch black darkness with nowhere to run. The ash fell for over 24 hours. The air was not poisonous at first, but by midnight, the remaining population lay choking from deadly toxins. On top of that, landslides of rock fragments and other debris plummeted those who decided to take shelter. There was so much ash that by the end of the violent volcanic surges, only the very tallest buildings were barely poking out above the surface. Underneath, the dead silently waited. It would be thousands of years before some of their corpses would see the light of day again. What happened next is a bit of a scientific marvel. In certain sections of the city, a special type of fine ash had covered the bodies. While most of the victims decayed as normal, a large portion of the bodies were also perfectly preserved as the fine ash hardened and molded around them, essentially forming a sculpture. These preserved bodies were first discovered in the 1700s, but were unable to be properly excavated in their entirety until over 100 years later. By this time, there had been one section of the city discovered in particular, known as the Alley of the Skeletons. There had been more remains than anywhere else. As such, the area received a great amount of attention. Excavators soon figured out that in some areas of the Alley of Skeletons, there were empty air pockets beneath the ash, and they quickly set about devising a plan to get the dead bodies out. Eventually, they figured that they could drill a small hole through the ash and fill the empty space with plaster. This way, they could mold the body's shape. Then, after chipping away the outer layers of ash, they were left with a perfectly preserved plaster cache of a human that could be removed and taken home. These preserved relics capture the tiny Pompeii citizens in their last moments of life as they either reach out to the heavens, slump over in defeat, or simply lay down to embrace their inevitable death. If you look closely, you can even make out the traces of their panicking facial expressions. One can only imagine the final thoughts that race through their minds before dying from a volcano. Fortunately, that's one thing that archaeologists will never be able to uncover. All in all, of the 1,150 human bodies that have been recovered from Pompeii, only 100 have been preserved as whole plaster casts. While nobody is sure exactly how many people died in Pompeii, they are sure that there are countless more bodies lying beneath the city, and unless they are in a hollow air pocket, then their bodies are completely unrecoverable, trapped in their ashen prison forever. Number 3, the Titanic boots. Over 1,500 lives were brutally lost at sea when the gigantic passenger ship slammed into an iceberg and sank into the North Atlantic in 1912. So for months afterwards, bodies continued to be discovered. In one instance, an abandoned lifeboat was discovered at sea containing the sun-bleached bones of three deceased passengers later that year. No one would think that new evidence of Titanic victims' remains would continue to surface 100 years later, but in 2012, that's exactly what happened. That was the year when an earlier image taken from the wreckage in 2004 surfaced. What that photograph showed was enough to convince scientists that there had to still be bodies locked away forever inside the depths of the Titanic. The underwater picture shows an old-fashioned boot on top of a coat, while another picture shows a pair of boots laying on the seafloor in such a way that there was no way they could have simply fallen out of a suitcase. Instead, scientists believe that the boots were worn by a body that has since disintegrated. If clothing could linger around the outside of the Titanic for 100 years, then federal authorities felt sure that there were still intact bodies on the inside of the wreckage, where fish and other scavengers could not reach them. As one federal worker who monitored the wreckage in 2012 puts it, "There are people inside. When you look at the numbers, it does not seem so implausible to think that there were still bodies down there." When the Titanic first sank, deep sea divers were only able to officially recover 340 bodies. Therefore, of the 1,500 people who died during the event, 1,160 bodies still remain lost. Is it really that hard to believe that at least one of the bodies is still floating around below deck in an area that is yet to be explored? Whatever the answer may be, the world will never know. In recent years, the United Nations seized control of the Titanic wreckage and declared it federally protected. The agency in charge, known as the United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization, said that the move was to protect the human remains inside. Perhaps the United Nations, which has some of the world's best scanning equipment, knew something that the rest of the world didn't. Either way, even if someone wanted to search the Titanic for remains, The bodies inside are now officially unrecoverable. Number 2, Mount Forever Rest. As the highest mountain on Earth, Mount Everest has been the ultimate test of strength for climbers from around the world. Whether you are a climber or not, everyone knows about this world landmark, but not as many people know that Mount Everest is literally covered in hundreds of corpses. Buried under avalanches or exposed on the base and slopes, dead bodies adorn the face of Mount Everest almost everywhere. One of the most famous corpses is a young Indian male who died in a 1996 blizzard when he sought shelter inside of a cave. For 20 years, the man's body, known as quote-unquote Green Boots, rests on the mountain's north side. When the snow is shallow enough, you can even step over his legs and his neon-colored shoes. While Green Boots may be the most famous death, he is far from the only one. Amazingly enough, a second climber died 9 years later right next to Green Boots. In 2005, David Sharp stopped in the very same cave to rest, and he eventually froze in place. As he was freezing to death, he was still fully conscious and alert, but was unable to call out as countless people passed by. He could only watch as they became smaller and smaller in the distance. Finally, a passerby heard his faint moans and began talking with him. He identified himself by name, but could say little more through clenched teeth. They moved him out into the sun to thaw him out, but it did not work. Ultimately, they were forced to leave him alone to suffer and die. His body is used as a marker guide for other climbers to this day. Multiple other bodies can be found literally frozen in time, many with their climbing ropes still around their waists, stuck in the exact same as the moment when they perished. Some of the bodies have the flesh rotted away from their bones, others are bleached by the sun, but many look as though they are simply taking a nap or a rest. You wouldn't know anything was wrong until you asked them for directions, or maybe even touched them on the shoulder. In nearly any survival situation, once you are found, you can expect to be rescued, not on Mount Everest. One of the most harrowing accounts would have to be from Ian Woodall, a British mountain climber with multiple climbs under his belt, and an eyewitness to plenty of tragedies as well. The climber first lost a team member in 1996, then encountered death again 2 years later in 1998. This time, he randomly stumbled across a personal friend named Francie during her last hours of life on Mount Everest. She frantically begged him with all of her remaining strength to stay and help her. The sad truth was that little could be done besides saying goodbye. There was no way to carry her. If he had stayed, he would have likely died as well. Ian was forced to abandon his struggling friend as she slowly died. The following year, they found her poor husband's body further down the mountain. He had fallen to his death while trying to find help. Ian felt terrible over the whole ordeal, and nearly 10 years later, he went on another expedition, this time to put Francie to rest. When his team found her, they moved her to a less traveled area for some dignity and draped an American flag over her. He also attempted to lay Green Boots to rest, but bad weather cut the expedition short. In general, the bodies on Mount Everest died in areas that are too dangerous to be recovered by helicopter. It is one of the few places on Earth where the dead sit in plain sight, and also deep underground, waiting for a proper burial that will never come. Number 1, Ground Zero. On September 11th, 2001, thousands of Americans lost their lives at the World Trade Center in New York after it was toppled by two hijacked planes. However, of the thousands of victims, only 1,640 of them have been identified. This means that more than 1,000 families are waiting for closure, and that there could possibly be thousands of body fragments beneath the newly built sites, or still in the rubble itself, which has since been transferred to other landfills. Jim Riches lost his son on that tragic day, and he still receives phone calls from the medical examiner's office whenever they find a shin bone, arm bone, or any other fragment of his remains. Jim has the fragments sent straight to the cemetery as they are recovered. Many other families like Jim's have little doubt that their loved ones' bodies are still within the piles of rubble that have been transferred from Ground Zero to landfills, or at least pieces of them that could still be properly identified. In 2005, the New York Chief Medical Examiner told families that the city would no longer identify 9/11 victims because it was too costly. But when 5-year-old human remains of the victims were found on the top of a bank tower roof and on a manhole, it forced the issue back into the spotlight. Since then, New York City has spent tens of millions of additional dollars to find 1,500 more pieces of human remains. Still, many of the victims' families feel that the city did not do enough work. The last attempt to find human remains was made in 2013. During this time, 60 truckloads of rubble from Ground Zero was transported to the Fresh Kills landfill in Staten Island for analysis. Here, government workers sifted through the wreckage to look for any tiny fragments of bones and skin tissue that could be identified. They found more than 50 possible pieces of possible remains. The Fresh Kills landfill is now being converted into a park, so whatever chances of recovering additional remains from there is now very slim, though additional body fragments could still be there. At any rate, many of the families agree that their loved ones are most likely still on this earth waiting to be rediscovered and finally laid to rest.